explain one of the things that I was thinking about it at lunch, or a question about individual, community, and agency. And one of the things I kind of was overlooking in the explanation is there are so many things that we can go off onto, but where we want to stay focused is what that primary need was, education. So everything that comes after it should be related to education. I think some of the conversation were some of the sources and some of the problems that grow out of it and stuff, but I think, you know, just for foundationally, if we just stay at that broad base of education and then work from there, it might make some of this a little more clear as we go along. We've got plenty of complex outcomes that we work with every day in our programs and in our services. And one of the things really I'm trying to look at, and Brenda made a good point about it, how do we work more efficiently and more effectively? And looking at how do we, you know, really kind of zero in on what some of those problems and needs are. So I think we left you on page 24. And one of the things is that we need to identify what the needs are. And you can use this space in the book if you want, or another piece of paper. And if I could get someone to read the instructions that's in the gray box.
Instructions, identify three issues, concerns, barriers, challenges, or other situations facing the clients in your community. And write these below using a couple of words or sentences for each. Be sure you can identify if it is a family, agency, or community need.
Okay, and how was one of the ways that we talked about that it can make it fairly simple to identify if it's family, community, or agency? How would you start a sentence?
Individuals,
mm-hmm.
or the community, our community,
mm-hmm.
and then what was the other one?
Agency.
Mm-hmm. Our agency has a need.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so some of the ways in terms of like when you're writing it, if you just put what it is, family, individual, community has, agency has, it makes it, that helps make it so easy to be able to identify what level it is. Okay, and so this is a good opportunity for you guys looking at your own programs and services and what understanding you have about the community that you serve to identify some needs. So what you're going to do is do at least three. And the rules are you don't just use one word. You can't just use one word. That's too broad. So don't put education as a problem or employment as a problem. Be a little more specific about it. And you can't say it's all three. You know, when you write the statement, you can't say, well, it's a family problem, it's a community problem, it's an agency. You know, rewrite it so that it's one of them. It may be all three, but for the purposes of this exercise, just pick one level. What I want you to do is to do this individually based on your experience with the agency, your experience with your program, your experience with your customers. Write three needs, and then we'll go on to part two of the activity. So I'm going to give you about 5 minutes to do this. Okay, don't consult with each other now. Let me know if I need to go put up partitions between some of these tables. Okay. Thank you. to finish these, what you want to do is take a look at the three needs that you have and rank them. It doesn't matter what level it is, but rank them 1, 2, and 3. Have you guys gotten to the ranking part of it yet, or you need more time? Okay, so now this is when you get to talk to each other. Okay, in your pairs. Mark, if you could pair up with Patty, please, and then I'll have you scribe for me after you do this pairing. Okay, what you want to do is discuss the three needs that you have and see if you can come to a consensus as to what the number one need is, number two need, and number three need is between the two of you. So compare notes, see if you can come to an agreement on your top three needs, and then rank those top three needs. Okay?
So are these needs or the issues concerning barriers and challenges? Because I sort of see those different. Well. Because, for example, I'm looking at, just to give you an example, because of my dealings with the HUD Healthy Kids Program, had a lot of work that we did out in the Coachella Valley, linguistic and cultural isolation affects that population. I wouldn't say that's a need, I would say that's a barrier that helps them, that prevents them from accessing resources.
Then what it may be, how would you translate that into a need in terms of the population? How does it impact them?
How does it impact them, or how do we as a provider answer that need?
Well, it depends on whether or not you're going to look at it from a community perspective or an individual perspective. I can see both. One of them is that perhaps the community lacks culturally sensitive resources or opportunities for its low-income community. That would be a community one. The other one would be, do the individuals lack language skills to deal with the business side of their life? Are they linguistically challenged to access resources and benefits? Okay, so yeah, so try and translate it into, you could either do it a community, if you see that the community is more challenged and has a greater barrier, or is it the individual? Are you getting complaints from the individuals, or are you getting complaints or observing it from a community side? Okay.
That depends on who's one.
What'd you say? So I just got to
community at least the number of jobs that are going to fall into the community. But the lead was very important. Yeah, it's not here, they were
going to be the
job. All right, this is just what I'm trying to
say. Yes.
To me, I just want to see the agency to think about it.
Okay.
English literacy is linguistic and cultural isolation.
So it's almost like that one is actually a transportation one. It's kind of a flip. You're talking about like the agency or the community. But let's call it for our sake. The agency, you can't get to them, but they can't put the agency. So transportation is a combination of one and two.
Access to health providers, transportation where knowledge base blockades. So either the people don't know that their CBR or something exists and they can't, so they don't know how to get to it, or they don't know.
Or the CBR doesn't know.
They don't know their outlet.
So it's kind of like, that's kind of, it's the same as our link. Well, that was the one. Agency hasn't had a presentation in this experience. Because it's limited funding. We have a CBO, but it can't be everywhere. It's here. And so everybody within 100 miles has to get it. It might not be good enough for the ones that are.
My final one was access.
And they're not doing any jobs, right?
Especially on the W. Mobile homes are all rotting.
I was sitting with my counselor. I didn't know how to work. And then.
So it's all related.
I was letting a vocation. I'm going to go to the university. I was thinking.
They also have built all these model structures.
Because that's what everybody else.
It's the same thing.
But mine is. All family.
And those percent.
Or the 20.
That is the.
Yeah, somebody, right.
I don't like the way she did that.
So it's just.
You know, my husband and I were both in this situation.
Yeah, that's a good way.
That's what.
We had to go through all the struggles.
I'll send money.
Do I get a name for the day?
Our kids.
You just get some. Do I get a star on my forehead?
That's plus and win.
I can see that. Yeah, and then. Yeah, basically.
And the animal.
Which is under.
Which is under.
So the family's got it.
It only has one.
And then.
Exactly.
So what parts have it changed?
Okay, so try and get your house. Try and get your priorities wrapped up.
It's just.
Like you said.
Cost of living.
We picked on their three.
I like the money.
That's three different examples. We're trying to serve as all of them. We can't find.
As a CEO, you can have money on drivers and rent vans for all around the various.
So what do you achieve?
Is it agency?
Agency is our agency.
Role program. Agency, what is that?
They always think that, you know, in our environment.
Okay, so you have 34 seconds to be able to get your priorities right.
But we have to learn ourselves to. When my mom dropped out in the sixth grade, my dad is an employee of the agency.
I mean, it is more common now. I don't.
Within our.
So are we supposed to come to concurrence as a group?
So.
A consensus, just in your care.
Right now.
So it's a finding.
And then, okay, yeah.
We're all six.
Huh?
All six. Top three.
You know, each pair come to consensus on a top three from your pair. Compare between your two things.
So you'll have to do a little negotiating.
Yeah. So, which pair wants to share first? And Mark, I need to ask you to describe.
Yeah, sorry about that. Okay, which pair wants to share? Okay, so what you want, now, this is what's really important about this, is that each pair should have a consensus of their top three needs. And you've got them ranked number one, number two, number three. I'm going to go around to every pair and ask you, what was your number one need? Was it family, agency, or community? If you hear the same need mentioned, don't skip to your number two. Give me your top number one. Part of what we're doing is that we're doing a count of how many times a particular need appears. So it's going to be real important that if you hear someone saying, you say, oh, that's already been said, let me tell the next one. You know, don't do that. Give me what your number one is. And we may paraphrase it a little bit, but always we'll, with an agreement that you're okay with the way that we paraphrase it. Okay, so Michael and Lynette, what's your number one need?
Individuals lacking financial education and understanding of budgeting.
Okay, so individuals lack financial education
and understanding of budget.
And understanding of budget. Okay. Lack financial education and knowledge, understanding of budget.
How do you like that, Frank?
No, it sounds like somebody needs something.
Probably a gift card. The second one?
No. Just give me number one first.
Oh, okay.
Okay, we'll come back around. If we have enough time, we'll come back around to your second and your third choices. Okay, so who wants to go next? Okay, Frank and Stephen?
Ours was essentially lack of access to services, but we just say transportation, lack of transportation.
Okay, but who lacks it?
Individuals.
Individuals lack transportation? Okay.
And to receive services.
To receive services. Okay. Okay. Who wants to go next? Okay, Olga and Lynn.
Individual need for job skills training and job opportunities.
Okay. So individuals lack job skills or lack access to job skill training. What is their need? What are they trying to remedy?
They're trying to get the training to be able to get the job opportunity, so they lack it.
So they lack skills.
They lack skills. Okay, can we use that? Mm-hmm. The individuals lack job skills?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Well, we're not having any repetitiveness in this.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Who wants to go next? Okay, Patty and Brenda.
Our community does not have awareness of resources on hand.
Okay, so now is it the community that doesn't have the information of the resources, or individuals aren't aware? Is it the, which one is it, the individuals?
Well, it could be both.
It could be both. Okay, so which one do you think has the greater problem, the individuals or the community?
Well, I think if the community is aware, because the community would be as a whole. Sometimes if you have a community that has, that includes people that have awareness of what they have, it could be like word of mouth and they tell others.
Okay.
And whereas if it's just an individual that doesn't know, then it's not really a...
So could we say, okay. Okay, so we're looking at the problem from two different perspectives. One is, I don't know where to go. I got a problem and I don't know where to go. And the other is, the community can't advise people where to go.
Yes.
Okay, so which of those two is closer to what your priority was?
The community.
Okay. We'll go, okay. So if we say, community lacks awareness of available resources? Okay. So far we've got three individuals and one community. Okay, and we got one group left.
Okay, so when he finishes writing.
Okay.
Thank you.
He doesn't get chocolates for writing fast.
Okay, so we think that families, which is individuals,
okay,
are not able to provide for their families, I mean, to feed their families properly, so that affects nutrition and this is all because of the lack of income.
So,
Or the low income.
Okay, so we've got a lot of needs mixed in there. So can we summarize it to say families are unable to feed their, individuals are unable to feed their families?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, so now one of the really nice thing about this is that you guys all started these sentences in an easy way to be able to determine whether the community, agency, or individuals. As managers and experts, you guys are what we call key informants. You are an expert in the fields of in the field of poverty. You've determined that based on your awareness and the knowledge of Riverside County, that these are the top needs that you see either that your customers have, individuals at a whole have, or communities have. And so it's real easy for us to identify the level. So number one is what? What level?
Family.
Okay, number one is an F for family. How about number two?
Family.
Family. Number three?
Family.
Number four?
Community.
Community. And number five?
Family.
Families. Okay. So it looks like, based on your expertise, that the top problems within the county happens to be individually related. It doesn't mean that those are the only problems. Remember that we had second choice and third choice, but these are the first choice. So, and we don't have any duplication. Now, it could be that number one, individuals lack financial education and understanding of budget, probably maybe impacts individuals are unable to feed their families, or maybe even job skills. Some of those are interrelated, but they all serve. And what's really very interesting is from the needs assessment that your agency just did a couple months ago, the top need that was identified by survey by community people was that employment, lack of resources, cost of living, which was child care, and lack of access to resources were the top three. And so you guys are pretty close, you know, close to that. So let's do number two. If you could put first choice above that and then second choice, start the next round. And then if any of your second choice comes up one of the number one choice, we're gonna put a little hash mark beside it, because what we're trying to see is what are the top problems needs. Okay, do you wanna go back in the same order that you want, or we got new volunteers? Okay, Michael.
Hashtag transportation.
Hashtag. Okay.
Hashtag.
You did too.
So if you could put a one behind here as well, Mark, because we've got it up here.
Yeah. So it's
yeah. Okay. Who wants to go next? Okay.
The agency has inadequate funding.
Yes, agency has inadequate funding.
It all has to deal with funding, huh?
Fran.
Who's asking who for money?
Okay. Who wants to go next?
Individual Slack education slash training for better paying jobs.
Okay. Do you think maybe perhaps this might be kind of connected with they lack the job skills? Mm-hmm. Okay, so maybe just put a slash there. Okay. Because where you're going with at the end of that is increasing their employability. And also, they don't have job skills. They need the job skills. Okay. So, who wants to go next? Okay. So, we're at the voluntold stage. Okay. So, I'm going to volunteer the ladies here. Okay.
The leaders?
The leaders, yes.
Lack of funding for higher education or affordable.
Okay. Education. So individuals lack affordable mm-hmm. education. Now, is it the individual lack or the community?
Community.
The individuals.
Okay. So so maybe they lack lacked access to affordable education.
Yes.
Okay. So individuals might access to affordable
money. They don't have money.
They don't have money. We have no money. Okay. And Olga and Lynn?
Lack of safe and healthy communities.
Okay. Lack of safe and healthy communities. Okay. So let's go last round, third choice. What's your third priority? Let's go back to Michael and Lynette.
Community doesn't identify or address low income
personal needs. Probably goes into the community lacks awareness of available resources. You could probably fit it into that.
Okay.
No, okay. Thank you.
So we'll go up there. Okay. Stephen and Frank?
No, it was number three.
No, what's your number three?
Number three. That was community has insufficient number of jobs.
Yes, okay. Yeah. Community lacks jobs.
Paying jobs.
Or not available.
Lacks jobs.
They need some sort of.
So, Patty and Britt, do you want to go next?
We're trying to structure our sentence.
Yeah. Okay. We'll help you.
So basically, what we're trying to do is say, individuals lack. I don't know if it would be a mentor or a plan, a plan for education, a plan for future goals. Because so many times, parents who haven't been educated, they tell their kids education is important. But they don't tell them how to get there. For example, like my parents, so I'm the first in my family to graduate from university. Education was important, career was important, so they would tell you that every day, but not how to get there, what to do. Until I had a mentor to tell me, you apply for these universities, you apply for the FAFSA, this is how you run for student government. These are tools. Yeah, coaching.
Okay, so maybe low-income people lack coaching?
Mm-hmm.
Or
yes.
Coaching slash mentoring.
Yes.
Yes. I know it's
that makes sense.
It's very
is more detailed mm-hmm. in terms of what you because it that could go across a whole bunch of things, mm-hmm. and it could be that if they lack education, then one of the strategies underneath that is getting them a coach that helps them, you know, figure out what the steps and whatever are. If they lack assets, then maybe they need a financial coach to help them with them. So it's life skill. They lack
a detailed plan to accomplish goals.
Or maybe they lack goal setting skills.
Goal setting skills with details or.
Right, because they don't have the knowledge.
Well, right.
So somebody has to give it to them.
Like a mentor coach that tells them how to get.
They don't have goals.
Because like, for example, I was in the same boat. My parents, all they could tell me was, you need an education, you need an education, you need an education. But they couldn't say, oh, you know what, you need to be thinking about this if you want to get to this point. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And then you also have to think about all the deadlines because they're important. Otherwise, you're not going to get to your goal. Mm-hmm. Right now, my youngest son, he had to come up with a plan. And since first grade, and it's in that they take it, he takes it with him, and he tweaks it and revises it at every grade that he gets to because, you know, their little ideas change. But from the very beginning, it's the end target is, you know, graduate from a university.
Okay.
But he keeps changing his plan. So he's got, you know, in middle school, this is what's out there, and this is what I can do so that when I go to high school, I can do these things.
Okay,
so when I'm in high school.
So maybe individuals lack life goals, coaching and mentoring.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah,
so individuals lack life goals, mentoring and coaching.
Outside of what's in their culture, because
it's already
in my culture, it was like, just get through school.
Okay.
Education's important.
And all of that, you know, all of the detail that you guys are giving us will surface up in other parts of and other modules and other parts of this needs identification. Right now, if we just kind of stay the general and try and get one statement, that'll be really good, really helpful for us. Okay, so we have the Litas, I think, are next, and then Olga and
We already did ours.
No, the third one.
That's the
third one.
Oh,
do you want me to move to the table across?
Well, okay. I think we touched on employment. That was our next.
Yeah.
Better paying jobs or wages available.
It could be as simple as a little.
Or no available jobs. It has to do with.
Okay. Now, if no available jobs, our community lacks jobs. Mm-hmm. Okay. So is that what you're looking at? Okay. So we'll put a hash mark there. Okay. And Lynn and Olga.
I said facing technical issues and problems and finding solutions. I don't know if that's more of an agency or an individual. Our crew are out there working, and there's situations that comes up every day, different solutions, you know, that we either work with the funding source or our trainer to find solutions to these issues that come up. And every day is different, but each individual staff has, you know, they've been trained to look at the WIS manual, to refer. But every week there's something that comes up from different people, from different staff.
Okay, and so how is that, is it something that's across the board where it becomes a staff development issue?
Yes.
Strengthen
maybe agency lacks
training, strengthen employees' capacities or?
Well, let's look at kind of look at what the problem is. The problem that they lack the knowledge, and you provide the knowledge, or you don't have access to the knowledge to provide to them.
There's just so much. This WIS manual that we have is not. You know,
okay, so the WIS manual is too big.
There's so much. and not every inspector experience the same. Mm-hmm. Even though they might do it for 8 years, 4 years, 3 years, there's every day there's something different. Paul comes in and talks to us every day about this stuff, you know.
Okay.
There's always so many technical craziness out there.
Okay,
interpretation.
So maybe agency lacks inspectors that have equal amount of experience and training?
Technical?
No.
There's never
okay.
experience equal or
No.
They all went through training, but everybody interprets it differently.
Mm-hmm. Don't you have an easier week?
Finish the contract?
Okay, so what would you like to see change?
They need to understand.
Yeah, it comes down to understanding and agreeing on what we discuss. We hear it out throughout the day, throughout the week, and then by Thursday we sit and we share.
Oh, that has to deal with the team.
Yeah.
Team growth. Yeah, it has to deal with strengthening the team, strengthening the workforce.
You know, in all honesty, Lynn, I would really have to work that through my brain to come up with something. And I'm not, y'all are new, unique. And I am not processing an answer for you. I apologize. That's real complex. I may have to write away to National for that. We've got this energy division manicure.
It'll become an exercise for next time.
We may have to go to National for an answer for that. So, okay, so we understand that it's an agency need. It has to do with staff experience and training, but how we kind of untie the webs in there is a little more complex than what I can give you right now. So, but let's go to the easy stuff. Let's count numbers here. We've got three right now that are actually tied for the number one. So we have transportation, lack transportation to receive services, lack job skills, and the community lacks awareness of available resources. Of those three, individually, how would you prioritize them? What would be your first, second, and third choice? How many would make individual lack transportation to receive services as your first choice? Okay, not even, you guys had that as your first choice.
Yeah. I always think jobs should come first.
Okay, so let's jump to how many things lack job skills is number one by show of hand. We got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Okay, so let's do 7 for job skills. Okay, how many think that transportation or awareness, how many things awareness should be number two?
Awareness of what?
Of available resources. Mm-hmm. Available, okay.
I think
four. Okay, so we've got four for available resources.
That's number two.
Okay, that's number two. And so is transportation falling by default to number three? How many think that transportation should either be number one? No, number two? No, number three?
Yeah.
Okay, mm-hmm. So we kind of have a consensus on that. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. Did you vote, Brenda? Okay.
Who voted twice? Seven
and four. Well, 7 is number one, community resources is number two, transportation is going to fall out as number three, unless it gets more than 7 or number four. Yeah.
So are we only voting for the top, the first choices, or second?
The top three, yeah, the first choices.
In the first choice.
Yeah.
I was waiting for the others this time.
Yeah. Because once you rank your first choices, it's automatically going to roll down to what your second and your third priority choices. You don't necessarily even have to get into your second priority. The important thing to remember is simply because it didn't rank up at the top doesn't mean that it can't be an issue or a need that you address. It just means when you go to identifying services and resources, where are you going to put most of your money? And this is what we call your expert opinion in terms of you guys or staff. But we have yet to go out and ask our customers. And that's what we're going to transition into next. Mark, if you could print that for me, I'd appreciate it.
This one here, can you print it?
Yes. Mm-hmm. I think this
is it. Wasn't a race.
Okay.
Wow, technology. I've never seen such things.
Isn't that really cool? That's one of our favorite tools of all of our workshops. When people come in and they do workshops in here, and you write it up there, and then you print it, it's like, where'd you get that from? And all, that panel board. And they've come down in price. So that is a wonderful tool. So now what we've just done is that we've taken the highest number of votes, and it's called a consensus or consensus building. It is a consensus priority needs assessment that we have done. And what we're looking at is individuals lack job skills are number one need. And by consensus in terms of a vote. It's not our only need, but it is by vote the number one. Now, we don't just take our opinion. We have to take the community opinion as well, our customers' opinion. But this gives us a way of comparison, looking at if you're on target with identifying, you know, what's going on in the community and what are the needs that are being brought to our table. And so, when we look at the logic model, you want to put your need in column one. And we're going to build a logic model, an individual logic model for each need. So was this an individual, was this a family, agency, or community need? Individuals lack job skills. It's a family.
Yeah.
Okay. And so up here, we would identify what level it is on our logic model. And you will see that copy of that logic model with the need on the page 25, at the bottom of page 25. Okay, now this is only one kind of assessment. It's not the only assessment that we have. If you'll turn to page 25 in your books, one of the things that we focus on and one of the Drucker question is, who are the customers and what do they value? And this is a two-part question. You know, who are they and what do they value? And we essentially have two types of customers. We have primary customers, and primary customers are generally the people who receive your services. One thing that's really interesting, if you want to know about customers, is that Drucker introduces the word customers as the same as being help seekers. So people who are looking for help is what he calls as customers. But the word customer also appears in the 1993 GIPRA legislation that requires the federal, remember that's the one that requires federal legislation that all agencies that receive federal fund have to do an outcome framework. So they're calling people who come to seek help as customers. What do you guys call them?
Customers, clients.
Okay, customers, clients.
Participants.
Okay, mm-hmm. Okay. And do you think that there might be a possibility of coming to a consensus on what one agency term might be for them?
I would call them customers.
Customers?
Mm-hmm.
Customers. Yeah, a lot of agencies call the people who come in and seek help as customer, they see it as a more respectful, a more dignified term, where it's less, let's say, it's more empowering, because it's like a consumer that is coming in for services as opposed to someone who is in need and seeking help and gets all of the labeling that goes with that. And so I know that I see it, clients, customers, participants,
applicants,
students, youth, you know, veterans, you know, a lot of different terms. But the GIPRA Act actually calls them customers. So the primary are the ones that get the direct services. And it's the most common customers that you will have. Other primary customers can be communities and agencies, or like your partners. I mean, agencies are parts of the agency. So say, for instance, a primary customer might be energy services. It might be mediation. It might be asset and wealth building. You know, it could be a division within the agency. So now, supporting customers are all those other people that have a vested interest in the agency. So who might some of those people be? The board. Did you say the board?
The board?
Mm-hmm. The board?
Uh-huh.
Who else?
Volunteers.
Oh, a good one. Volunteers, yes. Volunteers.
Grantor. Your grantor.
Yes, your grantor, your funders. Yeah, they're definitely a customer we want to keep happy. Okay. Who else is out there that you have relationships with that would be an important customer?
Partners.
Partners, yeah, mm-hmm. Partners. It could be elected officials, mm-hmm. are our partners. There's another term that we commonly call these people who have vested interest.
Stakeholders,
very good. So look at who your external stakeholders are as being your supporting customers, and your internal stakeholders, including your primary customer as being very essential and very important. So you need to identify both primary and supporting customers. You have to satisfy both, and you need to have outcomes that are written that address the needs of both of the of these partners. So, you know, one of the outcomes from elected official is that elected officials, they need to stay informed of the services. They would go right up here where it says community lacks awareness of available resources. Aren't elected officials a part of the community? Mm-hmm. Wouldn't it be really wonderful if all of our county supervisors were very well informed about what services, anti-poverty services, are available to their constituents, to their customers that are out in the community. The other important thing to know about customers, they are not static. They change, they evolve, their needs and their goals and their visions change and evolve. And so you always need to be taking the pulse of your primary customer and your supporting customer. And it's important for you as an agency to think ahead of how these trends may be coming about. Right now we're in a drought. That's something that's been changing for us. So you need to think about, how is this drought impacting our customers, both our primary customers and our supporting customers. 2008 was a major change in life for our customers with the economic crisis. So it's always evolving, and you always have to keep asking, who are our customers? And then the next question you have to ask is, what do they value? So from the customer perspective, is what is really important. It cannot be from the agency's perspective. That's like me telling Frank what should be important in his life. And I don't know about Frank's life. So for us as program managers and agency, for us to say, oh, this should be real important to you without going out and asking the customer what they value, it's like putting the cart before the horse. So that's why you need to do a community assessment of the customers, your primary customer, and of your supporting customers. And it has to be their own interpretation. One of the things, you know, I like the first priority, individuals lack financial education and understanding of a budget. Okay, but what if you ask, did a random survey and sample? I think that that's important. I think everybody should have a knowledge of financial skills, have financial capability. And that, and part of that needs to be a budget. What if they don't want to learn how to do a budget? What if that's not a priority of theirs? All they want to do is buy a house.
But they have to learn how to buy a house. They have to learn that budgeting is part of the structure of buying a house.
Okay. So,
or what if they don't make enough money?
Okay, so those are all our feedback, mm-hmm. our perception, our knowledge base. Mm-hmm. What is the perspective of the client? They may not think that they need mm-hmm. to do right. a budget. Now, knowing what they think and what they value will help us structure activities that will facilitate them reaching their goal and reaching the outcome. But we need to recognize and appreciate and understand what their perception is. They, part of maybe the financial education and learning how to buy a house is going to be, if you want to get from point A to point B, you need to do C. And that we need to teach them. And then maybe when you survey them again, the value shifts and change. And they'll say, doing a budget is a very valuable thing that I need to learn how to do if I want to buy a house. But you have to go with where they are in the moment. And that's how you address resolving, coming up with solutions of addressing those needs. So remember, it always has to come from the customer first. And it's from the beliefs that the customers actually have. And sometimes they're not tangent, you know, or consistent with our own beliefs. So sometimes we establish values for customers. And I just want to tell a little story about an experience that I heard in another workshop that I was teaching. There was a library that wanted to start a community literacy program. And they thought, oh, you know, low-income people, they don't know how to read. They need to have a literacy program. We get funding, we got a whole bunch of money, we got instructors, we got books and everything like that. We're going to have this class. And so it's going to be after hours. And so that parents could come and, you know, and get this training. It was based for adults. And so what happened was that they sent out flyers to the community, and it was all in, oh boy, dang, I've been telling this story for a number of years and it never occurred to me, well, yeah, they sent out flyers and people can't read if they're coming to a literacy program. But the thing is they sent the flyers out in English, but this was a largely Hispanic neighborhood, Spanish-speaking neighborhood. So no one not only could read it, but couldn't understand it because it was in English. And so they had an opening night. They couldn't figure out why people didn't come. And so they found out that, well, one, nobody understood the flyers that they sent out. Two, it was after hours where day childcare was a problem, and the library really hadn't accommodated for being able to take care of all levels of children, you know, from infant to, you know, young teenagers. And I don't know how the planning was for this, why they would build a library that was not on a bus route. It amazes me, but the library wasn't on a bus route. And so they didn't have transportation, they didn't have childcare, and they didn't understand that the service was even being offered. And when they came to ask the people who were coming, who did come, literacy wasn't even an issue or a value that they had. What they needed help with was job skill training, but they didn't make the connection between literacy and job skills. So if they had offered a program that helped you get a job, and literacy was one of the tools of helping you be more employable and filling out that application, they would have had, and you, and it was bilingual, and it was taught by bilingual staff, and there was like maybe a community bus that went around and picked up people, and they had babysitters and a childcare center in the library, they probably would have gotten a lot of that community out to work. But no one ever asked the community what they wanted. They built a program, got funding, and never asked if they wanted that service in the first place. So it's very important when you make assumptions about what your customers need that you need to go and ask them first, because otherwise you'll be running programs and you'll have no customers. So that's so important. Asking questions is another way of getting information from your customers. Surveys are one way. What are other ways that you could potentially gather data from your customers besides surveys? If I, Olga.
Maybe some focus groups, going out and doing some outreach to the community, talking to them at community fairs, being able to share about the services that we provide and what services they would need or their community needs that we don't provide, but maybe in the future we could.
Yes, yes. Focus group, having community meetings. Any other ways that you might be able to collect some information?
Reports.
Okay, now that's what you do once you get the information.
Oh, okay.
But how do you get the information to put in the reports?
Oh, your surveys.
What do you do, Lita, every day? Okay, you do workshops, and that's kind of almost like the focus group. But what do you do every day with the customers that come in and sit down one-on-one with you?
We give them information and we provide the services.
Interview them.
You interview them.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, okay, so between the two Litas, interviewing is another technique or way of being able to gather information. So there's a lot of different ways, but you need to ask. And it needs to be in a structured way so that we can collect data. Now there are two different types of data. Anybody know what the two different type of data are? Olga?
Quantitative and qualitative?
That's correct. Quantitative and qualitative.
Where's the big bucket?
I say her stash is going down.
She's using that.
Okay. So qualitative data is the story. That's one of the best ways to identify it. It is the face behind the numbers, it's the stories, and you usually collect them through like interviews or survey observations, getting people's opinions, and is collected directly from the customer, or it could be applicants. They call it, they're calling it subjects, you know, in this book. And so it could be someone who's not even receiving your services but is aware of different, as you said, challenges and barriers and things that are out there in community. And it's called, often called, primary data. Primary data is when you go directly to the source to get the information. Now, quantitative data is all about the numbers. It's about statistics. Surveys that you collect, workshop evaluations that you collect, things like that, and you aggregate the numbers together, and it comes out with, you know, an average or a mean or, you know, total something somewhere. And it's the number behind what people's concerns and needs are. And most often, particularly in larger agencies, they go to third parties to get this information. And this is called secondary data. This is information that is collected by someone else and reported out. And generally, those people are called third party because it may not necessarily be your agency. We have primary data from our needs assessment because we went directly to the individuals and asked them. But if someone were to come to us, say for instance, another department in public health were to come to CAP Riverside and say, we want to see your anti-poverty data, that would be secondary data to them because they didn't collect the information directly themselves from their customers. They're using data that we collected. We would be the third party institution that's providing this information. Now, do you guys know what third party institutions or agencies or businesses that CAP Riverside uses to provide data or get data through?
Census Bureau.
Yes. Number one, Census Bureau. Office of Department of Education, RCOE, the Riverside County Office on Education. All those Head Start numbers. You know, the wait list for Head Start. United Ways did community. Other foundations like the Community Foundation or the Riverside Community Health Foundation, who goes out and collects data from their customers so that we could see how many people are uninsured, how many people have certain healthcare problems and stuff like that. So that's all secondary data that we collect, and you usually get it from other agencies and institutions. You want to be able to have multiple sources of data. You have key informant, which is what you guys originally did. In terms of identifying what the needs were. You have your primary data, which is coming from directly from your customer, and you have your secondary data. And pulling all of these three data sources together gives you a very robust picture of what your customers need and what they value. It also validates what those needs are. If we were to have, I don't know, let's say your supervisor from your fourth district, Benoit, was to come in and say, I want to know where the poverty pockets are in my district, which cities have the greatest amount of poverty. More than likely, you would go to the Census Bureau and you would run reports to show what the percentage of poverty is within that district. But you would be able to give them that information. But if he says, how many people are complaining that they don't have living wage jobs out in my district? Then you would go to, say, a community needs assessment that was a survey of that district, of customers who actually lived in that district or community people who lived there who identified that one of their primary problems was that they could not find jobs. So, and it could be a narrative that they were doing. They could have been just answering at a focus group meeting and saying, oh, this is a problem. And it kept coming up and coming up and coming up and coming up. And so then we would tell Supervisor Benoit, okay, here's the ranking of the top 10 poverty pockets in your district. And from a community survey, 55% of the people identify that they can't find a living wage job in your through a focus group, that they could not find a living wage job. So that's how you're using a mix of the data. But it validates, because what did I tell them? Got it from the Census Bureau. And we did community focus groups to be able to validate that information that we're giving to them. So the next thing that we want to look at is identifying resources that we have. So if you turn to page, move over to the resources. 27, thank you. If you turn to page 27, what are those community resources? If I could get someone maybe to read that top paragraph that's in gray.
When establishing a community profile, it's not sufficient to assess only needs. An important aspect of community assessment is identifying the resources that are currently available or are being developed to address the problems, needs, or situations in the community.
Okay. And so how do you know what new resources are being developed?
Network.
How do you go that? Network. That's a good, okay, networking. Okay, how else do you find out?
Googling.
Oh,
research.
Yes, that is research, Googling these days. That's something that's not always been available to us and stuff. And how else might you find out?
Resource directories like Community Connect.
Okay, so your 211 information center. And basically most counties have a 211 program. So San Bernardino County has one. You can go to San Bernardino, call 211, San Diego, Orange County, LA County, and stuff. Another way is your own customers. When CAP Riverside did a community assessment, they brought in Welfare to Work participants to actually be trained as a surveyor and to go out in their community to do door-to-door survey. When asked about what resources they would share with others, came up with a directory that half the places we didn't even know about, but that these are people who were using these services and said, oh, if you're looking for clothing in so-and-so community, here's where you go. And so sometimes your customers are your best source of information for referrals.
Because they become resourceful.
Mm-hmm. They become resourceful. And one of the important things of being resourceful and finding services is that when you identify what the services are, you also identify the gaps in services. What services are missing? One of the problems that has been happening over the last few years, I don't know if you guys are aware of it, are the closing of a lot of food pantries. And one of the reasons why is that one of the major donors of food, the food pantry, stopped providing food to a lot of these shelters. They just had to pull back and identify where their biggest demands were, and these smaller food pantries and smaller communities started losing resources. They started coming to CAP Riverside to see if there was any way that they could get help. That's how the agency found out that there was a gap in service that they were, and it was getting wider and wider and wider. So a lot of times, you know, when you start researching based on what you hear from your partners or from community or from your customers, and you start Googling or researching or partnering with other people to find out where these resources are coming from, you know, it opens your eyes. And that can be something that gets addressed, or it may come up as a need, a particular need. So just brainstorm a little bit about, and if you want to write this on page 27 in the box, how do you gather information about resources? So we've got Google.
Networking.
We've got networking.
And research.
Customers.
And
customers. 211.
211.
Partnerships.
Partnerships, yeah, partners, yeah. The other thing is being aware of what funding crises are out there. When budgets are getting cut, particularly with social services, you know it's going to have an impact on local social services. You know, you're going to have more people who are homeless. Mm-hmm. You're going to have more people demand on food pantry. I remember in 2008, mm-hmm. there was a farm that was off near, I think, Temecula. And they were offering bags of from their harvest. I think it was like an orchard, and they were offering grocery bags of food. And they only expected maybe 100 people to come. This place was not close to the freeway exit, but they had traffic all the way from that farm up to the freeway, to the exit ramp, of people, thousands of people showed up at this farm to get food. And it was so totally unexpected. They just, you know, they couldn't serve them all. And so when there's a cut in services and there's an economic crisis, you're going to see the demand for services to go up. And that may be a shifting of, you know, what your priorities may be. Now, that might not be something, because it is a situational change, so you may not want to change or modify your mission, but you may want to revise or maybe one of your strategies that come under it. But if your thing is that you don't provide for hunger, that you refer out, then maybe what you might do instead of changing your mission to say, now we're going to provide services for people who are hungry, like food pantry, is increase your relationship with the people who do provide the food. You know, really do the research on referrals for current information on food pantries. Maybe see if you can fund some of the food pantries to be able to help them provide resources. So there's other creative ways that you can look at dealing with it without you having to change your mission or get into a mission drift. So I would like for you guys to turn to page 28 at this point. And this is basically analyzing the assessment data. One of the key things to remember is raw data is not information. It is the analysis of that data that becomes informative and helpful. So simply because you know that the top 10 cities in District 4 are these cities in terms of poverty pocket, that's just numbers, but it doesn't tell me the story behind each of those poverty pockets. It doesn't, until I analyze it, I may not know that District 4 has the greatest number of poverty pockets within the whole county. I need to be able to compare it and be able to analyze it. So if I could get someone to read the questions that you should be asking in helping to organize information down at the bottom of the page.
What are some of the root causes of the problem? Mm-hmm. Why should we be interested in the problem? What can be done to address the issue? Who should address the issue? Do we have control or partial control over the issue? Do we have the capabilities to address the issue? What programs can address the issue? What might we change in our agency that can help address the issue? Mm-hmm. And can we partner with someone to help address the issue?
Okay, thank you. And so, looking at those questions on page 28 and looking at the top need, individuals lack job skills, do you think we have enough information, or where would we go to get information, and how would you use it to figure out how we need to provide a solution for that? Just think about it for a few minutes. Look at the questions and see you know, what would you do to be able to make some informed decisions about dealing with the number one choice and using data to make that informed decision?
So are you asking where would we go to get additional data to answer these questions?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yeah. Or maybe what strategy would you use? How would you proceed in analyzing, you know, some of the data? What kind of data would you use? Need some help? Okay. Michael.
As far as that goes, I think we could use information from employers. If we could survey employers and see what their needs are.
That's okay.
See if they're having qualified people apply for the positions that they have out there.
Okay.
To hire those people.
Okay.
On that note, we could probably get the data from one of our partners, Workforce Development.
Yes. Yes, good, good. Oh, and you could probably get some information from the Department of Labor. What about going back to education? What about getting statistics about the dropout rates that might, you know, give us some insight into how people are lacking job skills? What about looking at the needs assessment to see if that ranks up there with one of the priorities that people are saying that they need training or they lack skills to get living wage jobs? It's another area that you might look at. What other partnerships might you go to get information?
EDD.
Okay, EDD, that's a good one. Unemployment. Mm-hmm. Would be a good place.
Or speaking with them one-on-one to see what they really want to do, because they might have other abilities and expertise they have that they might not, you know.
Yes, yes.
Coming down to what they want, what kind of work they want to get.
Want to do stuff. And one of the things that you might even look at that might be a good analysis is like to do a trend analysis that if the same kind of job skills keep popping up, that says something. Mm-hmm. If people keep saying, I want to be a bus mechanic, and you got, you know, 15 out of 20 people come in and say, I want to be a bus mechanic, well, that kind of guides you in the kind of direction of job skill building area that you might need. So basically, you want to look at information that's germane, that's important and informative to try to come up with a solution to the needs. And there's a lot of places. The first place you want to start is your primary customer, and then you want to go out for secondary data. And the good thing for you guys is that your planning department has a lot of this data or has the knowledge to be able to research where that data can come from. So a lot of agencies will have an internal department, and now that you're under Department of Public Health, you have the epidemiology department that can really help you in terms of getting statistics to validate the choices and decisions that you make in terms of where you're going to serve, how you're going to serve, and how you're going to be able to measure it. So this concludes this part of Module 2, and we're coming up on a break time. I just want to recap some of the key points. It stresses the importance of connecting a community needs assessment processes with the establishment of agency outcomes and agency mission. So the mission guides is the foundation. You shouldn't be going and addressing needs that aren't a part of your mission. If you're doing that, you have to have the conversation with why. You know, has the demand crept up? And if the demand has crept up, then you need to have something to validate that, which is your assessment. your needs assessment from your community. The assessment process can be accomplished very easily going back to your primary customers. It can be a fairly simple thing, or it can be a very complex thing. It recognizes key informant input, such as what you guys did earlier. You become the expert in the room. It stresses that it's necessary to tag each problem as whether it's family, agency, or community. You need to tag it as one of those levels. And proper identification of the problem sets the path for the solution. So you don't want to do a community fix for a family problem. One of the things that illustrates that is you can create jobs in the community, but if the problem is that they're lacking job skills, it doesn't matter how many jobs you create if they don't have the skills to be able to fill the job. So you don't want a solution of creating jobs, that's a community solution, to address a family issue, which is lack of job skills. And then Drucker's question 2 and 3, which is who's your customer and what do they value, is a very important dimension that you use in order to have this informed decision making about what you address. Then the concepts that the data must be analyzed before it becomes useful in planning is important to an agency response. Again, raw data is not information. The analysis of the raw data is the information that you need. And then on the logic model, what column does needs come under? Where's that big fat N? Number one. Thank you, Patty. I appreciate that. Okay. So why don't we take a 15-minute break, come back at